All right, I think folks can jump in here.
All right. Well, I will go ahead and get started. Just so everybody on this call knows, we will be recording this and it's streaming live on Facebook. There might be a little bit of noise in my background here, so forgive that. But I'm going to start recording here and we will get started. So hi, everyone. Thank you so much for joining us tonight. My name is Margaret Stern, and I'm the Communications and Outreach Coordinator or Manager for the Susitna River Coalition. And we are really excited today to have Heidi Hatcher, who manages, who's the Area Management Biologist for out of Glen Allen. But before we get started, I would like to thank our generous sponsors that make events like this possible. And that includes the Talkeetna Community Council and the Chase Community Council, as well as a variety of super generous individual donors. So also on the screen, you will see Melissa Hoyer, who's the executive director of the Susitna River Coalition. And today is also a pretty exciting day because we have Howard Carbone here, who is a Susitna River Coalition board member who will be introducing Heidi Hatcher. So I'm going to go ahead and pass this on to Howard. We will have questions at the end. Please feel free to type any questions into the Zoom chat or the Facebook chat. And Howard, I will pass the screen over to you.
All right, great, thank you so much. Well, I'm really excited for Heidi's talk tonight. I'm happy to count Heidi as a friend, and I was her former employer when she was an awesome naturalist hiking guide in Denali State Park. I'm also proud to say that I have seen a caribou in Talkeetna along the Talkeetna Spur Road years ago. And it's a rare sight around here down the boreal forest, but I've always wondered about how caribou use the Susitna watershed. And I'm looking forward to finding that out from Heidi tonight. Heidi Hatcher is the Area Wildlife Biologist in Glen Ellen for the Alaska Department of Fish and Game, where she has worked since 2015. She holds a Master of Science degree in Natural Resource Management from the University of Alaska Fairbanks. However, her interests, knowledge, and expertise with the outdoors and wildlife go back to the beginning. She grew up in North Carolina, the daughter of the game warden, and earned degrees there in ecology and environmental biology. She has worked as an instructor in skiing, snowboarding, backpacking, and paddling, and as an education specialist at the Alaska Sea Life Center. Heidi now shares her hiking, hunting, fishing, camping, archery, and photography adventures with her husband, her two-year-old, and the family dog. Please welcome Heidi Hatcher.
Awesome. Thank you, Howard. That was a lot to live up to. let me see. I'm going to go ahead and share my screen and try to pull up the presentation for you guys. This will take just a second. We're going to go. Oh, shoot, this one. Here we go. Now. It's just a little bit of a lag. Perfect. Okay, can you guys see my title slide here?
Yep.
Great. All right, I am for the presentation. Hope you guys don't mind. I'm gonna turn off the video because I find that it's distracting both for you and for me, but it also saves bandwidth. So I'm gonna turn my video off, but I can turn it back on later when we're chatting more informally. Thanks again, Howard. Like you mentioned, I am the Glen Allen Area Wildlife Biologist for the Alaska Department of Fish and Game. And so I have the pleasure of managing big game and fur bearers in, this isn't wanting to go, is it? Here we go. Game Management Unit 11, which is the bright green on the map, and Game Management Unit 13, which is purple. So in this area, we're responsible for populations of bison, moose, doll sheep, black bears, brown bears, wolves, and several other critters. But the most challenging and dynamic population that I manage by far is the Nelchina caribou herd. Now, I'll start by saying that if you've seen my Nelchina caribou presentations previously, I apologize, as much of this presentation is the same, but toward the end, I will touch on the latest info that we have on the herd and speak a bit more to the herd's use of the Susitna watersheds specifically. So For as long as humans and caribou have coexisted in Alaska, people have utilized caribou as a source of food, tools, and clothing. While methods of harvesting and interacting with caribou have changed over the years, the importance of this species to Alaskans remains paramount. In Inuit astronomy, the Big Dipper is actually a caribou, which shows how iconic this species is to Alaska because we have a caribou on our state flag. So if you're interested in caribou in general, Fish and Game last winter developed a caribou lecture series, and all of those lectures are available on the Fish and Game YouTube page. So I encourage you to take a look at those for more caribou information from across the state. It's generally considered that we have 32 herds of caribou in Alaska, the vast majority being barren ground caribou. Researchers have taken a look at the genetics of these herds, and if we're looking at a very coarse scale, most of the mainland caribou herds are somewhat related, and the herds on the Alaska Peninsula are more distinct. If you look more closely, though, at a finer scale, you can find some genetic distinctions between herds on the mainland. As humans, we like to categorize and compartmentalize things, and for all practical purposes, that makes thinking about and managing these animals much easier. So we break them down into herds based largely on location and behavior. Speaking in very general terms, caribou tend to be migratory. Calving areas and summer range are fairly consistent from year to year. Wintering range, however, is more prone to variation. So herds are often named based on their traditional calving areas. If you look at number 18 on the map, that's the herd we'll be focusing on this evening, as that's the one closest to home in terms of the Upper Susitna Watershed. So that's the Nelchina caribou herd, which on one hand is a typical barren ground caribou herd. What makes the Nelchina herd unique is that it spends spring, summer, and fall in a relatively accessible area of Alaska that I mentioned before is Game Management Unit 13. Now, most of you are probably pretty familiar with GMU 13. On this map, GMU 13 is highlighted in the cream color. The orange lines are roads, so you can see that Alaska's main highways run right through Unit 13, connecting the urban areas of Anchorage and Fairbanks. The herd provides subsistence and sport hunting opportunities for local communities, as well as for folks living in Anchorage, Fairbanks, and beyond. High demand and relatively good accessibility make this one of the only caribou herds in Alaska for which the size of the herd can be reliably moderated through hunter harvest, which has led this herd to become a notorious experiment in caribou management since the 1990s. This evening, I'll describe a bit of the background that led us to where we are now and explain how we currently monitor and manage the Nelchina herd. So caribou populations are known for going through dynamic boom and bust cycles. And these cycles typically occur over 40 to 70 year periods. And sometimes cycles may span even longer timeframes. This is a population graph from the Central Arctic caribou herd, but it shows what a typical population cycle looks like for caribou. And it's characterized by a long extended period of low numbers with slow growth, followed by a very dramatic increase in population size that often results in the herd overshooting the carrying capacity of the range, and the herd then experiences a precipitous decline. As a caribou population cycles through size, we tend to see another predictable pattern. The larger the herd gets, the wider it ranges. As the herd declines again, so does the area that it uses in a given year. When the herd begins to grow again, it expands the use of its range, roaming further each season. This map shows how the range of the 40-mile herd changed over time, which coincides with the size of the herd. As the range expands, the herd is more likely to mix with nearby herds. Mixing typically occurs during the winter season, which is when caribou migrate away from their calving and summer grounds. As herds mix, we also start to see more herd switching, when an animal that traditionally belonged to one herd may switch it up and follow another herd back to its calving ground in the spring. That animal may switch herds again the next year, or it may not rejoin its original herd for several years, if ever. Over time, like other typical caribou herds, the Nelchina herd has undergone these same fluctuations in herd size and range use. With this map, I'm going to run you guys through the history of the Nelchina herd fluctuations and how we got to where we are today. There are red stars in Glen Allen and Dawson, Yukon, which correspond with the red stars on the smaller map of Alaska and Canada, to give you an idea of where we're talking about. The orange lines are roads, and the yellow is the border between Alaska and Canada. Now, since this attempts for the Nelchina herd began in 1948, but they weren't conducted regularly. Prior to 1948, the history of the herd's movements was pieced together from oral histories and observations, giving us a decent idea of herd movements back to about 1860. If we compare historic range use with more recent range use and associated herd size, we can make some assumptions about relative herd size back that far. So on this map, the blue represents historic range use and the orange bars on the graph represent relative herd size. As we get to actual herd estimates, those bars will change to red. Keep in mind that the range maps I'm going to be showing you guys are very general. One thing that's certain with caribou is if you try to generalize them, they're inevitably going to find a way to defy the rules that you set. So early accounts tell us that around 1860, the Nelchina herd was pretty large and was ranging from Cantwell down south of Talkeetna, as well as all the way over to the Upper Copper River and even up the Chittenah River. The herd declined after that point, and by 1885, only a few caribou were wandering as far as the Copper and the Chittenah rivers. By 1900, the herd was using a much smaller range annually. The herd was spending the entire year in a relatively small area, mostly within the Talkeetna Mountains. Then the herd began to grow again, but how much and how quickly is unclear. In the 1920s, Copper Basin residents would drive to Paxson to hunt caribou in the fall and the winter. In 1925, the first caribou in many years came into the area near Chittenah, but details are a bit fuzzy around that time. So for now, I just have an orange caribou down by Chittenah to represent those observations. Caribou were also in the Katsina area in 1930. It's not clear, however, whether these caribou were from the Nelchina herd or the Mentasta herd, which is a nearby herd that is closely related to the Nelchina herd. And these herds are known to mix in years when their range use overlaps. Nelchina animals were first reported to winter in the Lake Louise Flats in 1945, which suggests that the caribou around Chittenah and the Katsina in previous years were more likely Mentasta caribou. The first count for the Nelchina herd happened in 1948, and there were roughly 10,000 caribou. As you see on the graph, red years are the ones with actual counts, whereas the orange numbers are those relative estimates I talked about. By 1950, the range of the herd had increased to 10,000 square miles, and caribou were traveling 370 miles annually. By 1955, the wintering grounds began to shift westward, and the herd was splitting into different groups seasonally, which is what we've seen the herd do in recent years. By 1960, the range had increased to 20,000 square miles, and caribou were traveling up to 980 miles annually. Immigration out of the area was documented in winter, and the Copper and Susitna basins were considered to be saturated with caribou. We have actual counts of the herd during that time, and the size of the herd reached 71,000 adult animals in 1962. If you include calves in the herd count, there may have been nearly 100,000 caribou using the range in the early 60s. Range assessments suggested that some of the range was negatively impacted by overuse during that time. In 1967, a count documented that the herd was in decline, which was confirmed with annual counts starting in 1970. I haven't been able to dig up range maps for that time period yet, but we can assume that the herd was not ranging as far during that period. The herd began to grow again in the 80s, and by the late 80s, the herd had started heading toward the Canada border in the winter. As the herd grew in the early 80s, an objective was established to keep the herd under 20,000 adult caribou. When that herd size was reached, the herd seemed healthy. So in 1984, the objective was raised to keep the herd under 30,000 adult caribou. In 1991, that objective changed from 30,000 overwintering adult caribou to 40,000 caribou total for the herd. With the new objectives, as the herd grew above 40,000 total animals, harvest was used to bring it back down. In the early 90s, the herd was migrating into Yukon and harvest was increasing to control the herd. In 1996, the objective was changed again, this time to add a lower limit for the herd. The idea was to keep the herd large enough to provide a reliable level of harvest annually, but also keep the herd below carrying capacity and avoid the big booms in population and subsequent years of low numbers and slow growth. So the objectives became to keep the herd within 35,000 to 40,000 total animals after the fall hunt. So that's what managers work to do. As the herd got larger, range expanded and more mixing and herd switching would occur. Sometimes it can be difficult to control herd growth when winters are mild and productivity is high. So the herd reached nearly 50,000 animals in 2010, and by 2013 was traveling into Yukon again. Keeping the herd within those objectives so far seems to be working, although the herd recently has spent several years at or above the objectives and is showing more variation in range use year to year. In 2017, animals went all the way to Dawson. The following year, the herd wintered closer to home. During the winter of 2019 and 2020, the herd split into different groups, some leaving the area, some wintering around Mount Drum, and some staying in Unit 13. During the winter of 2020 and 2021, the herd surprised us. The herd split, with some going up towards Chicken to overwinter up there, but most of the herd wintered in the Lake Louise flats of 13A. Which they hadn't done in large numbers for a couple of decades. That fall, we were concerned that we wouldn't be able to reach our harvest objectives to bring the herd back down to within population objectives. But when the herd overwintered locally, substantial winter hunt opportunity was available for permit holders, and we were able to reach our harvest objectives after all and close down the hunts in late January. That this past spring, productivity was high and the number of adult animals was back at a manageable level. So for this fall hunt, we transitioned from a reduction approach to a maintenance approach, which means that we are reduced harvest back down to what can be considered more normal levels when the herd is within objectives. This winter, the herd split once more, but virtually all the migratory animals left Unit 13. Some of them are overwintering in the Northern Wrangles, while others are on either side of the Canada border, spread from Dawson down past south of Beaver Creek. So keeping the herd within that objective range of 35,000 to 40,000 animals is what makes the Nelchina herd a bit of a management experiment. But how do we manage a herd that is migratory, unpredictable, and would typically have large swings in population size? First, there are some things that we need to know each year to know what the herd is doing. We need to know how big the herd is, how productive it is, and how many animals we can harvest to maintain objectives. We need to know these things so we can manipulate the one thing that we really have some amount of control over, which is harvest. Each winter, we have to determine the number of permits that are going to be issued for the coming fall season. And each summer, before the hunting season starts, we have to establish quotas for each hunt. The goal is to allow hunters to harvest as many caribou as we can to maintain that more stable population size without over-harvesting. Ideally, this means we don't drop too low, but we also don't let the herd grow too big. So, in order to get the information that we need to manage that harvest, we have tools that we deploy annually to help us tackle many of these challenges. Those tools are radio collars. Deploying collars on caribou is a logistically intensive task that we undertake typically once a year. By the first week of October each year, we've gathered darts, immobilization drugs, prepared the dart gun, gathered safety equipment, compiled our sampling gear, scheduled an experienced helicopter pilot, procured and prepared radio collars, and are ready to deploy those collars. We set out each October to capture 20 female calves of the year. I'm going to show you guys a real quick video to kind of see what that looks like. Let's see. Thank you. So from the helicopter, we dart a female calf. That's what the video was of, if you couldn't tell. I'm not sure how well it showed up. So we dart a female calf with immobilization drugs or a tranquilizer. And then we back off when we wait for the drug to take effect. When the drug does take effect, the animal sits down and is under the influence of a strong opioid. So it doesn't really care what's going on around it. So, oops, why didn't that happen? We bundle it up. My mouse got ahead of me there. So we bundle it up in a net and we use a weigh pole and a crane scale to get a weight on the animal. We then fit a collar on the animal and collect measurements such as mandible or jaw length. We might also collect a hair sample the hair sample we can use for genetic analysis. And we might also collect a blood sample to archive for future research. Now you'll notice that the photo of fitting the collar is not a caribou calf, a female calf, as I mentioned. So in addition to the VHF collars that we put on calves of the year, we also deploy, we try to maintain a pool of satellite collars in the herd on adult cows and bulls. So this photo is an adult cow caribou. Now VHF collars emit a radio signal that must be tracked with a receiver and an antenna, whether we do it from an airplane or on the ground. Satellite collars emit a VHF signal that we can track, but they also communicate with satellites, sending us regular updates on where the collar is so we can keep track of those collars from the office. Of course, we're not allowed to share recent telemetry data or specific location data, so this map is outdated, but gives you an idea of the data that we're getting from the collars. VHF collars, as you can imagine, are much less expensive than satellite GPS collars. So that's why we deploy GPS collars on adults, which are already recruited into the population and less likely to die within the coming year. Because they're expensive, we try to maintain 40 to 60 GPS collars in the herd, which means we only have to deploy more GPS collars every few years. Every year, however, we deploy 20 VHF collars on female calves of the year. Calves are much less likely than adults to survive through the winter. So by deploying 20 VHF collars just before winter, we can track those collars through the winter months and on into the spring to determine winter mortality and get an idea of how many calves are recruited into the population by surviving their first year of life. We track adult collars through the winter as well, as you can see here, to get an idea of winter mortality for the adult population of the herd as well. I mentioned that when we capture calves, we weigh them and we gather some measurements. These data give us an important glimpse into the health of the herd that year. Female calves during the first week of October can weigh anywhere from 75 pounds to about 150 pounds, but we like to see the average weight for our 20 calves that we capture to be around 118 pounds or more. If the average weight is below 115 pounds, then that's a sign there may be too many animals on the landscape, as the calves didn't have enough nutritional availability, either from the mother or the landscape or both, to grow as much as we'd like to see before winter. We measure mandible length and metatarsal length for the calves as well, which gives us a similar glimpse into the growth of the animals. We call these morphometric measurements. And when we see averages start to drop from year to year, or if we see a sudden drop, that's another red flag for us to suggest that we should work to reduce the overall size of the herd. The other important role of the VHF collars is that if a calf survives that first winter and is recruited into the population, we can then track her every year in the spring to determine how old she is when she has her first calf and whether she has a calf each year after that. When we combine this information for all of the collars that are active in the herd, then we have some really valuable information that helps us understand the movements and the productivity of the herd. So we've gathered winter mortality for both calves and adults. And then in the spring, we do a partition survey to see how many of our collared cow caribou are pregnant or have a calf. That tells us how productive the herd is that year, which is another indicator of herd health, as cows generally have one calf every year, but they might skip years if they're nutritionally stressed. Productivity of the herd is also vital for us to understand the trajectory of the herd, which helps us determine what the harvestable surplus will be from year to year. I mentioned that we track when a cow has her first calf. One important indicator of herd health is the partition rate of three-year-old cows. If a herd is very healthy and has plenty of nutrition available on its range, cow caribou will typically have their first calf at 3 years old. If the three-year-old partition rate drops, that can be a sign that the herd is nutritionally stressed, as cows are not having their first calves until they're 4 years old. The rule of thumb is that if the five-year weighted average of three-year-old parturition drops below 55%, we need to look at seriously reducing the size of the herd. Now, the other important part about these collars is that they inform herd distribution throughout the year. This lets us know where to find the herd to conduct surveys, how the herd is dispersed during the hunting season, when the animals start to migrate, and where they spend their winter. These collars are vital to addressing that challenge of managing a species that is both migratory and unpredictable. The other major challenge is knowing how large the herd is. In late June and early July, we're tracking herd distribution regularly, waiting for the caribou to group up in what we call post-calving aggregations. If they do group up, this is the one time of the year that we have a chance to count the herd, as the herd consolidates into just a portion of its range, and that generally happens to be in open terrain, luckily. When the caribou aggregate, we have a team of 4 to 5 super cubs that split the area between them, and each cub flies their area intensely to search out and find all the caribou that they can. Each plane has an observer, and any group that is found is counted or photographed to count later in the office. If we're really lucky, the caribou will form groups that are too big for us to count or to photograph in the super cubs, and we'll be able to call in a photo plane. Fish and Game recently produced a great 10-minute video about caribou photosynthesis efforts, and as a part of the caribou lecture series, there's also an episode about these efforts from Nate Pamprin and Tom Seaton. So if you haven't checked those out yet, I encourage you to check them out on the YouTube video. That Counting Caribou video especially has a lot of really great footage. Right after we conduct the summer count, we also conduct a composition survey. For the composition survey, we have a super cub spotter plane leading us to caribou and making sure we don't double count groups. And we have a team in a helicopter to fly low over the animals so the biologist in the front of the helicopter can call out the sex of each animal as we go over them. Now, this video I'm going to show you guys isn't exactly from a composition survey, but it gives you an idea of what it looks like as we're flying over the caribou during a composition survey. Oh, let's back up on that one. Stop that there to try not to make you guys sick. Let's close that one. So as we're doing that, a data collector in the back seat is keeping tally of what's being called out. In the summer survey, animals are characterized as cow, calf, or bull. And the goal is to categorize at least 10% of the population. So that might be 3,000 to 5,000 animals, depending on how big the herd is. This data tells us the proportion of cows, calves, and bulls that make up the population. Combined with the total count, we know about how many adults there are in the landscape, the ratio of bulls to cows, and how many adults we have available to harvest that season. We conduct a second composition ratio in the fall, composition survey in the fall, at the time that we do our caribou captures. And this time we categorize cows and calves, but we call bulls either small, medium, or large based on the size of their antlers. We can compare the fall calf to cow ratio to the summer ratio to have an idea of calf survival through the summer. We take the number of cows we had in the summer, subtract harvest from the fall hunt to determine the rough number of cows still on the landscape. And then we use the fall bull to cow ratio and calf to cow ratios to determine how many bulls and calves there are in relation to the total number of cows. Combined, this gives us our estimate for fall herd size. And in this example, that would be 37,515, which is within our objectives of 35,000 to 40,000 animals after the post-hunt, post after the fall hunt. So we have to issue permits in the winter, but our summer count and the composition survey give us the data we need to know how many caribou we can actually harvest in the fall. The goal, as I mentioned, is to have 35,000 to 40,000 caribou in the herd after the fall hunt. We also have goals to maintain 40 calves per 100 cows and 40 bulls per 100 cows, which is why in some years we may encourage cow harvest to keep the composition ratio of bulls to cows in balance. So the Board of Game determines how caribou harvest should be allocated among user groups. That means that the board decides what hunt should be offered for Nelchina caribou harvest opportunity, and this table describes what the board currently has in place. Hunters must apply for one of these permits in November or December of the year prior to the hunt, and if they receive a permit, they'll have the opportunity to hunt the fall season dates listed here. The board's created a youth lottery hunt for residents of Alaska, three different subsistence hunts for residents of Alaska, which are guaranteed permits, but have some restrictions associated with them. There's a resident sport hunt that's a lottery hunt, but it doesn't have the restrictions associated with it, with the subsistence hunts. And there's a small non-resident lottery hunt for which we can only issue permits when the herd is within or above objectives. So essentially the board determines who gets permits and how, and then it's our job to manage the harvest of these hunts to prevent overharvest. We do that by using the summer herd data we collected, and we establish quotas for each of these hunts. If the herd is quite large and growing, quotas might be very high and hunters may not meet the quotas. So the season might go all year or all season, all scheduled season. In which case the fall hunt closes as scheduled and a winter hunt will reopen for most permits October 21st. If the herd is small and less harvest is available, hunts might reach their quotas in the fall and then are closed down by emergency order. Typically, if this happens, these hunts do not reopen for a winter season. So that summarizes how we track and manage the herd annually, which brings us to the current status of the herd. This past summer, the caribou didn't aggregate enough well enough for us to count them, but we have really great, we did try to get a count and we worked with that as well as the really great survival information from our radio collars. And we're able to model the herd to estimate the number of summer cows at a little over 20,000. This fall, we harvested almost 1,600 caribou, specifically 861 cows. After our fall composition survey, we estimated that we have 35,500 caribou total, which is right at the bottom of our objectives and right where we want to be. Hunts were closed down by emergency order when quotas were reached in the fall, and no state hunts reopened for a winter season. Our fall calf to cow ratio was 45 calves per 100 cows, which is really good ratio going into the winter. And our bull to cow ratio was 38, which is back up there closer to 40, which is where we want to be. As I mentioned before, the herd split this winter with some animals traveling north and east towards and others overwintering in the northern Wrangles. When much of the herd makes that long trek into Canada, oftentimes we see lower recruitment rates than when they stay closer to home. So it'll be pretty interesting to keep track of mortality info this winter. As always, we look forward to partition surveys and the summer census to see how the herd fared. So I hope this helped explain a bit about the Nelchina caribou herd and how we manage the herd as a subsistence resource. If you consider that a hunter might get 60 to 100 to 100 pounds of meat off a caribou, and while we're able to maintain the herd at a relatively stable size and productivity, if we average say 1800 caribou harvested annually, that's around 144,000 pounds of meat filling Alaskan freezers each year. This is an amazing resource for our state, and the goal is to keep it that way for future generations to enjoy. On that note, I know you guys are interested in hearing a little more about the herd's use and connection to the Susitna River watershed. Now, I apologize. This is a Board of Game year, so I've been extra busy with preparing for the upcoming Board of Game meeting, which means I wasn't able to put as much time into updating this presentation as I would have liked. So I stole this map of the Susitna River watershed from a salmon project. It's a little blurrier than I thought it was going to be. I apologize about that. Since much of my work is focused on the eastern side of the watershed, in my biased opinion, this map is missing some of the major tributaries, such as the Black and the Ocetna. And for some reason, the Susitna above the Big Bend isn't highlighted. But we can make do with this map for now. Now I've mostly talked about the migratory portion of the herd so far. That migratory portion spends much of the time in spring, summer, and early fall in the Susitna watershed. In fact, I often wonder why it's called the Nelchina herd, because the calving grounds are actually located in the Susitna watershed. Granted, the calving grounds aren't up by the Susitna Glacier, but I haven't found any historical reference to them being near the Nelchina Glacier either. So I'm sure someone has an interesting historical insight into that name that I just haven't run into yet. The migratory portion of the herd spends much of the spring, summer, and early fall within the Susitna watershed before they start to head east. During these times, they're feeding on the plethora of vegetation and fungi that are available in the watershed during the growing season. But there are some more localized caribou groups that call the watershed home as well. In Game Management Unit 14, in the Talkeetna Mountains south of the Talkeetna River, there's a localized group of caribou that we call the Talkeetna herd. These are genetically probably not much different from Nelchina caribou, and sometimes they do mix, and sometimes some Talkeetna animals do migrate with Nelchina, but they're reliably caribou that hang out in this area year-round, and they're managed under a different hunt system, and for management purposes, are not considered part of the Nelchina herd. There's another localized group in the Cantwell area that has historically been referred to as the western non-migratory portion of the Nelchina herd. Again, the number of animals that stay or go might fluctuate from year to year, but there are still some animals that live in this localized area year round. Even in the very upper reaches of the watershed, we have still another localized group in the Clearwater Creek Controlled Use Area. Or maybe you could lump these in with the western non-migratory portion of the herd if you wanted. But that's the beauty of caribou, is once you start trying to define too many rules or expectations, the animals are gonna find a way to make your expectations fall apart. Whatever you want to call them, these animals, both migratory and non-migratory, call the Susitna watershed home. And they're really a pretty special resource for us to have here. Our goal is to be good stewards of these herds and the habitat so that future generations can continue to appreciate them as much as we do. Oh, the phone's ringing. Sorry about that. So with that, I'm happy to answer any questions you folks might have. You guys still there?
Heidi, I have a question for you. This is Howard.
Yeah, Howard.
Hey, so I wanted to ask about this localized group around Talkeetna that seems to be here year round. How do they use different habitat types through the course of a year?
That is a really great question. The Talkeetna herd specifically is actually managed out of the Palmer office. And they have deployed collars in the past, and they have more information on seasonal distribution and movements. Most of their collars right now, they don't have any on the air right now, but they still do composition surveys and at least each fall. And so they would actually specifically about that Talkeetna portion, they would have more information about how they're using the range over kind of on your side of the world. Unfortunately, I'm not as familiar with the Talkeetna herd, what we call the Talkeetna herd, as those guys are out of the Palmer office.
Okay, thanks.
Sorry.
All right, we have a few other questions coming in from Facebook as well. I'm having a little bit of trouble getting my audio and my video going, but can you hear me, Heidi?
I can hear you, yeah.
Great, awesome. So Barbara Parker asks, if the herd scatters or splits, does that mean that the calves separate from their moms? How does that work?
That's a great question. When the herd scatters or splits, the calves stay with their moms. They're pretty much like Velcro to their moms. But the herd will split up into different factions. So the adults will split up and the calves will follow their respective adults.
Okay, great. Another question that we had from Facebook from Mark Johnson is, why were we allowed to shoot cow and calf caribou in Unit 13 when the hunt numbers had been so restricted? And why was it not designated a bull-only hunt?
That's a great question. And we did get that question a lot. It was kind of a misconception out there that if we had a bull-only hunt, we could have higher quotas. That's not actually the situation we were in. We had a lower bull-to-cow ratio than we needed. So we actually had an excess of cows to harvest and not an excess of bulls. So by opening it up to bulls and cows, which we don't ever encourage people to harvest calves, in my opinion, you know, if you're going to harvest a calf, that's a pretty small animal. That's not a lot of meat you're going to get on your tag. So we don't encourage harvesting calves. And we don't encourage, you know, when we're in a situation like this, we never encourage the harvest of a cow with a calf either. It's not illegal to do that, but we don't encourage it. But had we this year, when we had lower quotas, had we gone to a bull only hunt, it would have actually been an even lower quota because we had less bulls available because of our bull to cow ratio. Does that help answer that question?
Yeah. So it's all about, or not all about, but a lot about the ratio and just maintaining that.
Great. Absolutely. Yep. That's one of the management objectives that we have to shoot for.
Great. Cool. I got my video back. all right. So Ramon Hedges asked, or it says that he spent a week at the headwaters of Caribou Creek and it was terribly overgrazed. So what does that observation indicate to you?
You know, Caribou Creek, I'm thinking in the one in 13A, there's so many Caribou Creeks, but I'm thinking he's probably talking about the one in 13A. So we were in a situation, and the reason that people were so used to us having such high quotas for the last several years is because we were in a situation in the last several years where we had excess caribou, and we were trying pretty hard to reduce the size of the herd because we were concerned about the herd overgrazing their range. So if you saw some evidence that looked to you like the head of Caribou Creek may have been overgrazed, there's a couple of different things going that can play into that. One is that, you know, that's why we were working so hard to bring the herd down, as we didn't want them to harm the range. But the other is that particular area is an area that they spend a lot of their calving and early summertime in that area. Well, post-calving and early summertime in that area. So, you know, if you had, there could have been, say, a group of anywhere from 1,000 to 5,000 animals camping out in that particular area that you were in the early summer. And that can localize, that can, you know, they can eat quite a bit, so that if you're in there after that, it looks pretty impacted. And the question is whether that vegetation is going to regrow after they leave, or typically, you know, what really affects a herd when they really overgrow their range or overfeed their range, you know, if they're doing a lot of damage to the lichens that they're relying on in the winter or their winter habitat, that especially lichens take a long time to grow back. So that can be, those can be hit a lot harder, whereas the vegetation that grows more quickly, they might mow it down, you know, early summer, and then it's going to grow back the next early summer and still provide some food. So it may not have been as big of an issue as it looked, but we certainly have been intentionally trying to reduce the herd so that they don't overgraze their range.
Awesome. Yeah. Along the same lines, the same fellow asked, what sort of habitat and vegetation surveys do you do?
So right now we aren't doing any habitat or vegetation surveys specifically for caribou. We've got some moose stuff going on that is in caribou range that will provide us some information that's also applicable to caribou. For our management program, what we do is look at those health indices of the herd to see how the herd is doing. And that gives us an idea of the habitat, the nutrition available out there on the range. There historically have been range habitat assessments for Nelchina herd, and that's how our objectives for managing the size of the herd were established, was based on those historical research projects to look at the habitat, and when the herd was higher, looking and seeing how the habitat was impacted. That all informed the management strategy to keep the herd where it is now.
Barbara Parker asks that in April of 2018, she observed a small group of caribou crossing the Talkeetna River near the Sheep River headed northeast.
That's fantastic.
Yeah, very good. And then she also asks, where do the caribou that are in the Talkeetna Mountains calve?
In the Talkeetna Mountains. So those localized groups, whether it's the localized group in the Talkeetna Mountains or the localized group, you know, in the Clearwater, or there's a localized group in the upper Gocona, you know, whichever localized group that you're talking about, they're pretty much using that localized area year round. So I can't tell you specifically where, you know, what drainage the Talkeetna animals are going to have it, but in general, you know, in that local, what we call localized area, compared to what the Nelchina, the migratory animals, are doing with their big movements. So yeah, they'll be calving in the Talkeetna Mountains, where they're kind of spending most of the year.
Would that be higher elevation, lower elevation? Does it matter?
It can vary, you know, and it can vary based on season and predation pressure and that sort of thing. And it can also vary by herd. So specifically the Talkeetna, like I said, they're not actually my herd. so I can't talk specifically to them, but I know based on from year to year, even though they're calving in the same area, they might use different drainages within that area, or higher elevations or lower elevations from year to year. So it can vary a little bit.
Interesting. Lloyd Donaldson asks, how much does predation from wolves and or bear affect the mortality rate compared to other factors? How much? Yeah.
That's a great question. So in general, for caribou, neonate mortality early on, like I said, this is general. There's been a lot of neonate mortality studies on different herds. And usually what you see is early on, bears are a big predator of calves as they're dropping. Typically, wolves aren't as big of a factor until later in the season, when the animals are a little bit older. Usually early on, it's the bears. But you know, every year things are different. So in Unit 13, we have a lot of bear harvest. We think we have a declining brown bear population. So relatively lower bear predation than maybe in some other areas. We also have a wolf control program for moose, so relatively lower wolf predation than in other areas. Even though the wolf controls for moose, we suspect that has helped caribou, and that's part of the reason we had such a high abundance for a while. But there are certainly other factors. Some years, this is another thing that varies from year to year. Some years the caribou might migrate a little bit late, because of seasonal conditions, snow conditions, this or that. Maybe creeks are starting to open up as they're migrating. Sometimes when that happens, they're actually dropping their calves before they get to the calving ground. And oftentimes those calves are not making it. They're, you know, getting washed down rivers. You know, they're not able to keep up with mom pushing through the snow to try to get back to the calving ground, that sort of thing. So in some years, it might be kind of more environmental factors than necessarily predation. That's the bigger calf mortality issue.
Yeah, what is the least ideal condition for caribou in terms of winter? Is it like a colder or a more rain and ice? Is it deeper snow? What's the worst case scenario?
Usually the situations where you've got a lot of rain and ice and freezing and thawing events, kind of like with sheep, you know, if you get a layer of ice, it's harder for them to break through to get to the lichens and to the foods they're looking for. With the snow, you know, they're made for digging in the snow. That's one of the theories about why the females have antlers, is to help dig in the snow. So unless it's a really, really deep snow year, you know, that certainly can affect them, but usually the snow is kind of what they're made for.
You're getting a lot of kudos over here. Loy says, thank you so much for a great presentation and for offering the question and answer session. Barbara also says, thank you for this presentation. And she recommends Seth Kantner's new book, 1,000 Trails Home, which is about, I believe, the porcupine herd.
I've heard good things about that book.
Yeah, it has I looked at it at the bookstore the other day. And it's beautiful. I have a few more questions for you. Howard, do you have some more as well? Okay, got it. So are there any hypotheses for how those different, like the localized herd was, different localized herds were delineated from that main migratory herd? What's kind of the thought around that?
No, that's one of the great things about caribou is they're such a mystery. Kind of why they do what they do is one of the big questions. Why, you know, first off, when they start to migrate and where they decide to go, why they decide to go, you know, all the way to Dawson one year and maybe Lake Louise one year, how and why they make those decisions is kind of a big mystery. Also, why one faction might decide to go to Dawson and the other one decide to go to Mount Drum, you know, that's a big mystery. Why one group decides it's going to stay home, you know, that's kind of probably more of just a ecological strategy. It's kind of like the difference between moose and caribou. Moose choose to be more sedentary and eat lower quality foods so that they're not using as much energy, whereas caribou choose to move further and eat higher quality foods, search out those higher quality foods. Maybe, you know, just some caribou decide for whatever reason that they don't like that migratory strategy and there's enough food available to live a more localized life. Why some caribou are non-migratory compared to others is kind of a mystery. That's one of the beautiful things about caribou is they are a puzzle. There's a traditional native saying that no one knows the ways of the wind or the caribou, and that's in a lot of ways pretty accurate.
Yeah, it seems like when I was sharing this event, a lot of people were posting different observations that they had, and some people had seen them like way down on the Yetna and all over the place. And are those just anomalies? Do you think that they're going to be heading in these different directions, just, or is it just some lone critter heading out there?
It can be either or. And you know, those animals, kind of what we call the western non-migratory portion of the herd, often mix with delta animals, because the delta herd will send animal, you know, I say send, but some delta animals will decide to come down into unit 13. They'll mix with Nelchina animals. Some of them will decide to stay and just kind of become part of the non-migratory portion of the herd. And some of them will mix with the migratory portion of the herd and just turn into Nelchina animals and never go back to the delta herd. So there's definitely animals coming down through, you know, kind of the Yetna area and that sort of thing from time to time. So.
Interesting. They're interbreeding, so they're not totally genetically distinct, but can you discern which animals from which herd based on genetics?
Sometimes, and that's a question that there are some current research projects going in to see if you can look more closely at that. There have been some genetic studies that have shown, for example, Mentasta caribou and Nelchina caribou are genetically very similar, but if you look at the mitochondrial DNA, you can actually distinguish Mentasta caribou, some Mentasta caribou from Nelchina caribou. And mitochondrial DNA are passed down from the cow. Mm-hmm. And so that suggests that the cows have more fidelity to their breeding grounds. And that's kind of kept the cow portions somewhat genetically distinct. But yeah, I don't know. Some pretty interesting questions. There are some projects going on to see if, let's say, you get a sample from a caribou that was harvested in Canada. Can you tell if that was a Nelchina caribou or a 40 mile caribou or, you know, a Heart River caribou? There's some research going into that, and I think it's going to be pretty hard, but we'll see what they come up with.
Okay, cool. And then what do you anticipate in the next decade, say, with climate change effects? How do you anticipate that affecting these different herds?
That's a really great question. Climate change is always, for us, it's always kind of up in the air whether it's going to be beneficial or detrimental to these animals. You know, the different possibilities of what could happen, it's really impossible to say. Caribou especially, though, are really dynamic and resilient animals in terms of their range use, their habitat use, their ability to adapt and survive. So I think ultimately I see caribou being in our future for a long time. And certainly climate change could change how they are distributed across the landscape. But yeah, it's pretty impossible to say exactly what's going to happen with these guys in terms of climate change.
Right. Yeah. Well, I could ask you a million more questions, but does anybody have any final questions that they would like to ask Heidi today? I guess I have one more. we wait and see if someone else chimes in here. When we're looking at antler size and body size, you said that when the population gets pretty large, that you start to see decline in the body size of the animals. And does that correlate directly with the antler size? And so are you kind of managing for trophies as well?
Not necessarily. And the body size that we're looking at specifically is calf, calf of the year, kind of 4 or 5 month old calves, how big they've grown in that amount of time period. That's what we're looking at specifically. When we do our fall composition surveys, we do assess the bulls by antler size, small, medium, large. And we do that just to give us a general ballpark on what kind of the age distribution of the bulls is. And it's not exact, you know, because age can affect antler growth, nutrition can affect antler growth, but at least having an idea of roughly the proportion of small, medium, and large bulls in the bull pool gives us an idea of a very general idea of age distribution, just to give us, you know, kind of just another index on how the herd's doing. We don't specifically manage for trophy. The Board of Game determines how different herds and different populations should be managed, whether they should be managed for trophy opportunity or whether they should be managed for just subsistence productivity. And this is pretty much a subsistence herd. So we don't have any specific management goals to provide trophy opportunity. But what we have found is when we're able to kind of keep the herd within the management objectives where it's supposed to be, and able to provide both bull and cow harvest, then we do start seeing more larger bulls than we used to see when the herd was lower and only bulls were being harvested. So
interesting. And also, are you ever looking for observations from community members as they're out in the field?
I always welcome. There's nothing in particular, let's say, that we're asking for, but I always welcome observations, especially if people see things that they think are particularly unusual, or that they have questions about, or if they just want to update us. You know, sometimes I have people who email me very descriptive descriptions of their entire hunt that they went on. You know, I don't get to spend as much time out in the field as I would like. I mostly on my personal time, I'm getting to spend some time out in the field. Not as much time during work hours necessarily as I would like. And we're going to try to change that a little bit. But any observations from folks out in the field can only help. So I always welcome if anybody wants to share their observations. Go for it. We'd love to hear it. So
great. Well, thank you so much. I guess last call for questions here on both Facebook and Zoom. This has been super interesting, and thank you so much for coming and sharing.
Thanks for having me.
Yeah.
Thank you, Heidi. This was great. And thanks to everyone who was on Facebook. It was great to have these two platforms work so well tonight.
Thanks. Great job, Heidi.
Thanks, guys.
Yeah. Great to see you. Thank you.
Really? Yeah, good to see you too.
All right. Well, I guess we will sign off for tonight if there aren't any more questions. Thank you so much, Heidi, again, for being here, and for Howard for introducing, and Melissa for facilitating. So,
thank you, Margaret.
Yeah, have a good night, everyone. Thank you.
Thanks, bye. Guys.